Right now, Mr. Fischler will actually go back and look at some of these, maybe a bit more in detail, some of the causes, but then look at, you know, what kind of priorities should we apply as we go forward, and also how maybe to shape some of the fair policies as we look forward. Mr. Fischler, go ahead.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you very much for inviting me to this very important conference. I was listening already in the morning to many speakers, and it's really fascinating what this initiative of the Barilla Center is able to do here. So what I would like to speak about is, first of all, about what should be the vision for the future global agricultural policies. And then I would like to deal a little bit with what is called global governance and the priorities about global governance. And finally, I would like to speak a little bit about what is the contribution of Europe and what has Europe done so far and what is expected, which contribution is expected from Europe. So, what is the challenge and what is the vision? To put it in one sentence, I would say it is not enough only to speak about global food security. What we need is a balance between food security, environmental security, and social security. Because we should not repeat the mistakes the industrialized countries made mainly in the 1970s and 80s, where we increased productivity at the cost of our environment. And we cannot ignore that global food security can only be achieved if we are able to reduce poverty in the world. So these three things must go together. And we need a balanced approach, a balance between, let's say, economy, ecology, and social responsibility. And in addition to that, this system must become sustainable, because what we have already heard, it is unsustainable. And if we don't change our agricultural practices drastically, then it will remain unsustainable. So what are the priority actions? First of all, clearly, in a world with 1 billion people starving from hunger, combating hunger is, let's say, the primary priority. And in addition to that, it is we have to think about systems and not only about single tools and single approaches. So therefore, in this combating of hunger, climate change mitigation and adaptation is very much involved. We have heard a lot about this, but if we think in terms of global governance, you know that at the moment the conference is going on in South Africa, and almost nobody in the world believes that there will be a positive outcome of this conference. So where is the global governance in this context? And more or less the same is with the protection of biodiversity. We will have the conference next year, Rio+20, and is there a lot of hope that there will be a lot of progress in this context? Almost no hope. So the next question, I will deal with the next question later on a little bit, is innovation and knowledge transfer, and why I think it is so important that we establish something like a know-how chain in the agricultural sector. And then there is the question of a more effective development cooperation. This is a pertinent question, because we ignore our own promises in the meantime almost 30 years, because 30 years ago, or more than 30 years ago, we promised that we would pay about 0.7% of the GDP for development cooperation. And then there is the question of less distortive farming policy, and in this farming policy concept, clearly there is also agricultural trade involved, And if you think what will happen in the fall of this year in Geneva, is there an expectation that we will see a positive outcome of the Doha round? Well, nobody in the world believes that. So we are really forced to change our positions and to coordinate our positions better and to try to make real progress. Let me come back for a moment to the question of hunger. There is a huge discussion going on about this, but in my view, three elements are crucial. If we don't find better systems, how we enable the 500 million subsistence farming families in the world to make progress, to get a better living, and to find better living conditions, if we are not successful with that, we will never be able to reach the millennium goal number one. And here you can immediately see that if you would like to bring out of hunger these 500 million subsistence farmers, then it is not a single tool issue. It is not a discussion about using or not using GMOs, or it is not only a discussion about water scarcity. It is not only about discussion about fertilization and so on. It is a discussion about systems. And therefore, if we would like to change systems, we need a holistic approach. And what this is, I will tell you in a minute. So, and the second problem is still what we, for example, see at the moment in the Horn of Africa. This is acute hunger problems, and therefore, for such acute problems, there are only food aid programs which can help a little bit to reduce the biggest difficulties. What is this holistic approach? I think we can learn from the Green Revolution. We can learn from the Green Revolution something what was positive, but we can also learn something from the negative developments within the Green Revolution. Positive, in my view, is the approach which they have chosen how to find innovation and how to convey this innovation to those in need. This was the first time that a real innovation chain was established in India. What we can also learn as in the form of negative experience is that the initiators of the Green Revolution were too much oriented towards a technological approach only. So they thought that with better fertilization and with better seeds, you can make the whole change. But now with the salinization and with other problems, we can see also what negative consequence this has. But in the end, what is needed are tailor-made regional concepts going beyond agriculture. If we would like to help farmers, we have to look at all the strengths and weaknesses in a concrete region, and we need the ownership for the change by the people living there. It cannot be done only from outside. We need the policymakers in the regions getting involved and the local people getting involved. Democratization, so to say, is really a must if we would like to make the necessary progress. And finally, I think we should be clear also about control and enforcement, so that we avoid big mistakes or big shortcomings. About the innovation and knowledge transfer, I would say that it is a pity that, for example, also here in Europe, when the decision was made about the so-called Europe 2020 strategy, the word agriculture is not mentioned in the whole concept. So is agriculture a knowledge-based part of the economy or not? I would say it is, and I would say we should immediately stop neglecting the importance of research and development in this sector. And we should make it we should make R&D to one of the backbones of this of the future. And we should also look here in a bit a broader sense, because a lot is said in the meantime about knowledge-based bioeconomy, but in practical terms, not much progress is made at the moment. And clearly, this goes together only if we improve also education and training and new forms of extension services. It must be clear, if we would like to make progress in developing countries, we cannot neglect agriculture in the development cooperation. What you see here is the share of the total of the agricultural spending out of the total development cooperation spending in the last 20 years. And you can see 20 years ago, 20% of the total international development spending went to agriculture, and now it's less than 5%. So certain experts told us in the last 20 years, it's much better to invest in infrastructure, it's much better to invest in industry, but not in agriculture. And we are now living with the consequences of this wrong concept. So, I mentioned already the importance of the fulfillment of our promises, and I think if we would like to continue to be serious about the millennium goals, then we additional new financing forms are needed. For example, in the context with the CO2 trading systems or any other form of financing, but with the present level of financing, we will not achieve the goals. And let me move on. Yeah. And then about trade policies and agricultural policy. So we know that the Doha round is for the time being stuck, and that a political impetus, a political will is needed to deal with the obstacles in this reform. Clearly what the goals are, this is known for a long time. It is not necessary to describe all this in detail. We can come back to that in the discussion if you wish. But in addition to this trade policy issue, market transparency is also more and more important, and I'm really glad that the G20 decided in the summit in Cannes to introduce transparency rules so that we know better what's going on the agricultural markets. But there's a new phenomenon, and this is that we are living in a time where the so-called derivative markets, it's a part of the financial markets, almost exploded. And there is an overlapping between the effects of these derivative markets and the real economy, especially the commodity markets. And therefore, if we are not able to introduce better disciplines for that, then I think we will continue to see enormous volatile agricultural markets. But here, the G20 was less successful. There was a promise that we will see a new financial architecture, but so far, it's only a promise. And then what happened in the European Union? last point. So, what is this? Yeah. We in Europe, we are absolutely in favor that export subsidies or subsidization altogether will be phased out. And you can see that we are serious about it. Last year, we used less than 1% of the community agricultural budget for export subsidies, and this year it is for the first time ever at the level of zero. Then there is the question of market access, and here the applied tariffs in the Union are much below the bound tariffs, and we reduced the intervention, which was a heavy measure in the past, to a very few products and to a safety net level. So for the, at this stage, for example, it is not used at all. And we invented or negotiated new trade agreements, unfortunately bilateral trade agreements because of the lack of progress in the Doha round. And Europe is for the time being the only major economy who implemented fully the everything but arms concept. As far as domestic support is concerned, we moved away from the trade distorting and competition distorting domestic support measures, which is the so-called amber box in WTO terms. We moved first with the 1992 and the consequent reforms towards blue box measures, but with the last reform in 2003, there's a total change, because in the meantime, in 2011, this is only until 2009, in 2011, already 90% of the total domestic support is green box compatible. What effect does this have in our production and in our markets? You see here the reduction in EU price support. They are enormous. They are going up to 80% reduction of price support. So there is a real change on for almost all of the products. Then this has clearly enormous impacts on the markets. As you can see, that in the beef sector, the European Union is in the meantime a net importer, and also in the corn sector. And you can also see what is very obvious in the sugar markets. So we are no longer a net exporter of sugar. All our sugar exports, our supported sugar exports, disappeared. And in all other sectors, our export level is reduced, except in the pork meat sector. If you look, what are we still exporting? Because as you can see, we are still a big exporter, the second biggest in the world. But we are not exporting commodities, we are exporting other products. The biggest export product of the European Union in the meantime is wine, and there's only one commodity, and this is wheat, where we are significant exporters. As you can see, in all the other products are added value or final products, and if you then look where these products are going, these products are not going to developing countries. These products are going to highly developed countries. So therefore, our export situation is no longer harming the many countries in the developing world. And on the import side, you can see that we are also the biggest, by far the biggest importer of agricultural products in the world. And if you look what are we importing, then you can see we are mainly importing commodities, especially we are importing defeat. And this is, by the way, one of the big problems more and more, that we don't have a protein concept in Europe, and this would be urgently needed. Finally, what is our relation to the developing countries? Here you see the trade balance with the developing countries between in the last 10 years. And you can see here that we are a big net importer from developing countries. And as far as the quantities are concerned, Europe alone, the European Union alone, imports more agricultural products from the developing world, and especially from Africa, than all the other OECD countries together. And with this, I would like to stop here, because we need time for discussion.